This policy regarding the recruitment of lecturers. I must say, we were not quite sure what this was about, in the sense that you didn't say what we should clarify regarding this this policy. What is it about this policy which is of concern to you? We were tempted to write back, and then we decided against that because we thought you would say we are using tactics to avoid coming here and so forth.
But again, add something. We are actually concerned with the STEM issue, and now everything is being stigmatized, and we want to know whether your lecturers are now oriented to perform the task you are giving. If you need teachers in the primary secondary school, when they are actually we are recruiting properly oriented teachers to fulfill the ambitions, stigmatized everything.
Well, thank you very much. Yes, please.
About that, I think I don't know whether it's now policy that, you know, all lecturers at universities are supposed to have, doctorates. Now, is that now going to be in line with STEM, or it's now just a question of them just having a doctorate and then be able to lecture? Now, you're also saying teachers' colleges and polytechnics are going to be universities. So what's going to happen with those lecturers now? Are you going to upgrade them, or will they continue to be lecturing in view of your changed status of polytechnics and teachers' colleges? Okay. I think that is basically the
reason.
Yes, to say what's going to be the recruitment policy on lecturers or teaching staff for these various institutions.
Mm-hmm. I'm really indebted to the chair and the deputy for their very useful clarifications and guidance. And I think it is proper that the committee raises those questions so that through you, which is Parliament, the public can be better informed about what is being proposed, and not only just for the purpose of consuming that information, but to feedback and to give us input from the honourable members, but also the constituencies that they represent, because these are valid issues and concerns. We will clarify that. But before doing so, may I just quickly highlight as a backdrop to that discussion, and in some cases, through that highlight, maybe explain some of these issues, and where they will not be sufficiently explained, obviously we prefer an interactive approach where we exchange ideas. First and foremost, Honorable Chair, it is very important to understand that nothing has been done to change anything. This is very, very important. The only thing we've taken a step, and we say we can't see us going back on that step, is supporting 5,136 students last year into lower six, and 5,136 students this year into upper six, and 5,136 students into lower six. It's a commitment. And we would like to do this for the next 10 years, 2026. And we think that will produce a new skilled Zimbabwean who will make a difference. That's the only thing. The rest, we haven't done anything. And surely we can't imagine that supporting what's this number now? 5,136 and so.
10,172.
Yeah, that can't be anything wrong. I can't imagine a rational person taking issue with that. But Maziti raises, and the one is considered this, and this, and this. We can't see that. The rest, we are engaging, and we will continue to engage, to cross the T's, and dot the I's. Before we implement, we don't think that higher and tertiary education is a field for considered or badly considered or undeveloped experiment. We're not, you know. But we're also happy that everybody knows that higher and tertiary education is unique insofar as it is a semi-autonomous sector. It runs itself. We can set policy parameters and so forth, but when it comes to the nitty-gritties, it's the institutions that come up with these things themselves through their structures. And we are very confident that even though there have been challenges, including exodus of staff and skilled people in our country for a range of reasons that we all know, we still retain quite some very skilled people running these institutions. And they will be the last ones to take a dive into the unknown. They don't operate like that. That's why we are engaging with them. So I hope the members will have the comfort of knowing that we are taking views. We haven't implemented anything to start raising red flags and so forth. And when we have the package, we will still come here, and if that package is raising issues, fix it together. That's number one. Number two, which is on the first page, it's very important to understand that with respect to tertiary education, which includes the industrial trade training and testing centers, the polytechnics, and the teachers' colleges. These are civil servants, as we speak, all of them. And in terms of section 199, subsection 2 of our constitution, the public service is responsible for them. The public service is their employer, not us. So you might want to call, if there are issues, you might also want to call the Public Service Commission and say, what do you think? In fact, I think it's necessary. Because when you read this document, the compendium, you will find that these institutions are very unhappy about their current status, which is a much more serious problem than this other one. Are you stigmatizing everything? You know, so we don't want to be like that guy who drinks one too many, and when he leaves, realizes that he has lost to drive his car, realizes that he has lost his car keys on the side of the street that is dark, but sees that the other side where he didn't lose his keys is light, and goes there and starts looking there, hoping to find the keys. That will not happen. You will not find your keys. There is quite some light shining around STEM, but that doesn't mean all the problems are there. In fact, because there is light, you might not find the problem. If we want to understand the impact and the implications of STEM, let's first understand where we are, the dark place. That's where the keys are missing. And it's important, if we're going to represent the interests of the lecturers, both in tertiary institutions and in higher education institutions, let's understand their current state. Is everything okay? The information I was exposed to when I visited each and every one of our 46 institutions is that there are serious problems there. Even if you are not going to introduce STEM, there are serious problems. And if you talk about lecturers, they ask me, for example, why are we being pegged against civil servants in your ministry and not against, these are the tertiary ones, and not against lecturers at the universities? And they tell me, and it's in this report, that time was when they used to get their salaries pegged at 70% of what the university lecturers get. And nobody's speaking to those issues, you know. So we say, you know, please take note the employer is the public service, number one. Please take note that currently there are a lot of issues about the policy, the recruitment policy, that need to be resolved even without the STEM issues. And that, yes, we will take into account the implications. If they transform into degree awarding institutions, it may give them new opportunities to deal with problems that they currently have, because that might redefine their status and so forth. The next issue, Chairman, that we want to highlight in as a backdrop to this, I was hoping to present this in the form of to do a PowerPoint presentation, thinking we were going to be downstairs. In fact, I should have apologized that we came a bit late because we were downstairs there. Then we found there were soldiers there, and it became an issue coming here. I was surprised that my colleagues didn't face that challenge. So there are no page numbers, because I was going to go slide one, slide two. I apologize for that. But there's look at the current authorized establishment of the lecturers in tertiary institutions, all of them. They are supposed to be 4,332. For the institutions to say, yeah, we're adequately, now we can do all the programs and so forth. But those in post are 2,355. That gives a vacancy rate of 1,977. But because of the underperforming economy and all these issues that the Treasury has raised and the pressure it puts on the Public Service Commission, they have reduced the establishment almost by fear. I would say, without casting an aspersion on anyone, that really threw a thumbsuck exercise to 2,501, which now is declared and seen as the authorized establishment. The authorized establishment is not the required establishment. So the authorized one is 2,501. And then those in post still are 2,355, giving the impression that the vacancy rate is those who we need to hire is 146, which is not correct. And there's a serious, serious difficult situation there. You can imagine the implications of this. I think the numbers tell their own story, Honorable Chair. It creates all sorts of problems. Yes, some of the problems would be, do you have, what's the number of the stigmatized one here? But we are saying to you the problem is more than that. Because if the others for the other fields, you know, are not there. The pages that follow, Chair, really call your attention to the relevant instruments, you know, the circulars of the public service that affect the recruitment of lecturers. This circular number 12 of 2004, and in particular, but there are those three others. Some of the problems that are associated with the current situation include the fact that because we are not the employer, the vacant posts, and we were just talking about the 146 in general, or those that occur in the course of the year, advertised after seeking the permission or authority of the public service. If you don't have the permission, there will be no advertising. And the period between the request for the post and the advertising of that post is not fixed. It can be anything. But also, after it has been advertised, the actual filling in terms of the approval is another process. These are the challenges that your institutions are facing if you engage the principals of the colleges. And because this, especially in terms of the teachers' colleges, involves another ministry, we have to coordinate with the Ministry of Primary and Secondary Education. And I think that, as I'm sure the honorable members are aware, this has its own challenges, which do not always lead to an efficient and effective system of filling or identifying what the real posts that are required are, and then filling them. The real problem is that when you deal with intellectual or academic institutions, it's better that you enable, empower them to make their decisions within broad parameters. But if you come up with a centralized system of dealing with these issues, then you have problems. And under that heading of implications of centralized recruitment powers in the Public Service Commission, we explain what the difficulties of treating lecturers as civil servants is. And this is a very serious issue. And we are going to propose, in fact, the colleges themselves are working on the proposals. The Honorable Deputy Chair said that you understand some of these institutions are going to be turned into universities. We don't have a proposal like that. What we have is a proposal to transform them into degree offering institutions. And a degree offering institution is not by definition a university. A university is technically different from that. Yes. We are offering a diploma, but we are saying, no, you see, let's upgrade this diploma so that you offer a degree. We are not saying you now are going to offer master's degrees, PhD degrees. That diploma will become the new highest qualification you can offer as a college, which they already are. They are colleges, all of them. They are. Now, with polytechnics, we are not even coming up with a new idea. They have offered degrees before. If you look in their history, and they are offering degrees right now, the Bachelor of Technology degree through the National University of Science and Technology, and they are complaining. They are saying, we are the ones who are teaching these people and so forth. Those guys are not doing anything. They come here, increase the cost for us, and blah, 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 blah. So why are they offering the degree? And we are not recruiting properly because we have to use their rules when we, you know. But the polytechnics, some of them are already offering the bachelor's. So it's about rationalizing that situation as opposed to transforming them into universities. We will not transform them into universities. With the possible exception of the teachers' colleges, which are concerned that having perfected this field over the years, some of them since before independence, the likes of Morgenstern, Nyadire, and others, they find that because we now have 20 universities, some of these universities are encroaching into the teaching field and offering diplomas. And some saying, well, we can even offer degrees and so forth. But they are not the best in terms of developing the right pedagogics. The pedagogics have been perfected by the colleges. And the colleges feel that some of the graduates with the diplomas are better than the university ones, because they come up with funny things and so forth, but they are not good teachers. When they go in the classroom, they encounter all sorts of problems and so forth. And they think that one way of dealing with this issue might be now to transform together, not into many universities, but into one university. They are already, as you know, operating through a scheme of association, most of them, with the Department of Teacher Education. Yeah. Otherwise, in general, it's not true that we want to, you know. But there is the complaint here is that if you have a centralized system, you really don't bring the best in academic institutions, which would rather have this issue of staff recruitment done by themselves, or if not done by themselves, but at least done through their line ministry. But that it's centralized in terms of the Public Service Commission, they say, is a problem which they want to deal with. And then the worst thing is, of course, about the appointment freeze. This is one development that has really, really terribly affected our institutions, the freeze. Because you freeze the staff side and unfreeze the student enrollment side. You keep saying, enroll these people, enroll. And we know, honorable members, if you don't enroll them, they will complain at your community level there. They'll say, what the hell is this? But we can't treat them the same way we're treating government departments. If the enrollment is continuing, so must the recruitment to match the figures. We can rationalize in terms of minimum sizes of classes and so forth, but a one-size-fits-all or a hammer's every nail type of approach is creating problems. So that's why there's this suggestion that maybe the function, if we stay in terms of the current arrangement, should be delegated to the ministry, and that the appointments, the freeze should be lifted lifted for critical areas, and the lecturing areas appear to be good candidates for such treatment as critical areas. That is the side of the tertiary institutions, the teachers colleges, polytechnics, and the industrial trade training and testing centers. It's different from the university side. So I'm not sure what page number this is. You're with me. So that one, lecture recruitment in universities. The situation of the freeze is the same, but we need to understand that at the university, they are very clear standards, best practices that universities must adhere to religiously. For example, if you are teaching an undergraduate or in an undergraduate program, you must have a master's as your minimum qualification. And these are not things to negotiate with anyone. You must have. Secondly, if you are teaching in a master's program, you must have a PhD. We don't want a person with a master's teaching another master's. We can't have that. And when you're talking about, if you are teaching a master's, you must have a PhD. If you are teaching in a PhD program, you must have a PhD and also be a professor. You must profess something of an academic nature. You must be a specialist. Profess. You must profess knowledge and leave Makandewa to prophesize. But you must profess. Now, the Honorable Deputy Chairman raised a point, observation that it's being alleged that this one suggests that a master's could be a minimum qualification. this logic to say if you're teaching in an undergraduate program, you must have a master's, suggest that a master's could be. But obviously with universities growing in number and also competing, and we want them to compete regionally, globally, and so forth. And with the pressure from the colleges, the teachers' colleges and the polytechnics, it is a good thing that the minimum qualification for being a lecturer at the university, unless there's something quite unique to your field and different, must be a PhD. This is a good thing. This is what the situation is elsewhere. And we have not come and said, this is the requirement as a ministry. But the University of Zimbabwe has taken a lead. That's the policy at the University of Zimbabwe. And when one does it out of 20, the rest must follow, especially if that one is the mother university like the University of Zimbabwe. Now, when we support a policy that our institutions are doing as semi-autonomous institutions, I think that's a good thing. We can't be the one saying, no, no, don't do this, you know, this is bad, continue having masters and so forth. You know, we will be saying like we are opposing progress. We think this is a good thing. But the way the universities do this, they give their lecturers time. They don't say, tomorrow you must get a PhD. They know how much it takes to get a PhD. And it's not a thing that they just, like you said, came up with this thing 4 or 5 years ago. And we're going toward the end. It's those who have been caught without doing anything and so forth who are now running around to ask politicians to complain as if we are now going to give them the PhDs ourselves and so forth. But the majority are recognizing this policy as a sensible policy, and what we are doing is to support them. We will not be surprised if Zimche takes it on and makes it as a requirement in support of promoting minimum standards in terms of the body of knowledge in the various fields. Otherwise, the universities are not affected by that public service commission requirement. Their recruitment policy is guided by the Labour Act, as well as the Enabling Act of the universities, if they are public universities, or the charters, if they are private or non-state universities. And then they also have recruitment, staff recruitment, and staff promotion ordinances that guide that process. And we think that is adequate. The only problem is that the Treasury continues to threaten the stability of university staff by saying the universities must meet their full costs from tuition fees. There is no university anywhere in the world that meets its costs through tuition fees. Nowhere, even across the Limpopo. The only exception that some people use is that in Germany, higher education is free. But that economy is performing very well as a result of that model of getting universities to become incubators of industry and so forth, and we cannot compare ourselves with them. But the money must come from somewhere to support a university. The principle we are requesting you to consider and hopefully agree with us on it and support is that any responsible authority that starts a university must meet the obligation of the employment costs for that university. Otherwise, it must not start a university. So if you are a church and you start a university, you must not turn around and say, oh, I can't afford the salaries and so forth. So why did you pay? I mean, why did you start the university? You can say, no, I started it thinking I'll make money from tuition and so forth. It's not that kind of business. Similarly, if the state starts a university, it must pay for it. It's a sound principle. You can't have the state establishing a university only to turn around and say, survive on your own. Find the money from tuition. We had the question being asked by the Honorable Minister of Finance that he would like to know what happens to tuition that goes to the university students. Well, this is a very good question. The answer is out there in the air. The students are not affording tuition at both state and non-state institutions. They just can't afford. A growing problem that you have had to deal with as our committee is a situation where in a number of your cases, many students who have been enrolled but have not paid tuition are barred from taking their exams, and they come to you. And you've been calling us to say, hey, look, students have been locked outside there and so forth. So you want to know what's happening to tuition that's not being paid. If we were not having that problem, that is a growing problem. There is a default in the payments. They come up with arrangements. They don't meet the arrangements and so forth. And it's a sorry situation. It's a sorry situation that requires national policy to respond. And we can't respond by simply saying, no, the wage bill is a problem. I think we have to respond by saying, what are some of the ways of raising revenue to make these institutions viable and contribute to the development agenda? This is the situation with the universities, Honorable Chair. Lastly, just to highlight that, of course, it's not about only lecturers at the universities. We have the key offices that are called designated posts of Vice Chancellor, Pro Vice Chancellors, Registrar, Bursar, and Librarian. These are appointed different in terms of the Act, and these also involve us as a ministry receiving the recommendations and forwarding them to the Chancellor. There isn't a particular problem there, except, of course, for you to note that as Treasury insists on universities becoming viable enterprises, we may have to review the definition of the competencies and qualifications that are required of these five designated posts. What kind of people should they be? Should they just be taken from academic people in the faculties, or should there be people with different managerial qualifications and skills and so forth, similar to approximating some of the skills we get in the private sector? But in relation to STEM, we are pleased that the universities are going to take a leading role, because some of them were actually set up for that, like NAST, HIT, UZ has quite a lot of that, because it was the only university and it needed to develop a strong science base. CAT, BOSE, and these others, including the likes of LSU and the new universities coming up in Manicaland, Mashonaland East, and Matabeleland South. But as I indicated, the content of that will be greatly assisted by the outcome of the national skills audit that we are going to do in June. That is the highlight on your second question, Honorable Chair. And I'm compelled to ask yet again whether...